That's pretty.
To get a seat, especially those who are here early. My name is Lindsay. I'm one of the many but not enough volunteers that run the Senate Theater on behalf of the Detroit Theater Organ Society. So we're an all-volunteer run membership organization. We have membership forms at the merchandise counter, and you volunteer or email if you just want to get on our email list, sign up over there as well. So if you are a paying member, you can come in and play on this one-of-a-kind historical theater pipe organ. So it was built in 1928, and you're in for a real treat tonight, because after our silent movies, we do chamber tours. So we are going to, when we bought the theater back in 1962, instead of making it into the walls, we had to like shimmy through to service the parts, because it's basically an analog synthesizer that's building-sized. They just enclosed the backstage. So this is one of the only theater organs in the world where you can just kind of stroll through and look at almost all of the instruments. Most of the percussion, which you'll hear some of tonight, is in the original chambers at the Senate Theater, which had a much, much smaller organ originally. So stick around for that. You know, we'll turn the lights on, we'll put the screen up, takes a minute, we have to pull the organ out, but you can line up over here. And we will, you know, if you want to go sign up to volunteer and then come back down and do the chamber, you can do that. We're doing a 50-50 tonight, so that is a raffle where half of the proceeds go to system support the theater, you know, keep the lights on, do plaster repair, restore the organ, replace it slowly over time. And the other half, you can win up to $100, and we'll do a couple other prizes with that as well. And there will be an intermission about an hour into the film, and so you can buy 50-50 tickets. We'll close the intermission doing the raffle. And if you like what you hear, we have another silent movie coming up November 5th, Flesh and the Devil. It's Greta Garbo's breakout role. It gets built as a romance a lot, but I mean, tell you, I was watching it, and I got to the end, I was like, this is more of an erotic thriller than anything else. It's really wild, and just it's a beautiful film. The cinematography is incredible. And last but certainly not leastly, I'm really excited to bring out to the stage a friend of mine, Josh Gardner. He's the founder of Cinema Lamont, who partnered with us on Nosferatu and earlier this month, Dracula en Español. So I'm going to invite you.
Thanks, Lindsay. It's so great to be back in the Senate. As mentioned, I'm Josh Gardner. I'm the founder of Cinema Lamont. We're a nonprofit that fosters cross-cultural understanding through the power of world cinema. And so in essence, we do pop-up movies all over town. tonight is one of our shows. But if you want to check out our website and social media, we have a lot of fun stuff coming up, including some more Halloween programming. We'll be showing The Beyond from 1981 on the Collect rooftop at Eastern Market on Tuesday. And then we also have coming up a really exciting, fun documentary called Meet Me in the Bathroom, which is about the New York City indie rock scene in the early 2000s, The Strokes and the AAS. And then all November, we'll be doing some noir screenings in Hamtramck. So I'm sure some of you are interested in some of those films, so check us out for more information. But I'm so excited to be here for Nosferatu, celebrating the 100th anniversary of this incredible film. Thanks for coming out.
Our fantastic organist for this evening, Stephen Warner, in Mueller's Money Hats, and he's one of his most prominent is as the music director at the East Jefferson Avenue Presbyterian Church. He's going to introduce our film tonight, and he'll be here, you know, after the film as well, when you guys do the chamber tour, to talk a little bit about the organ and his approach to accompaniment. So I want you to give a big round of applause for Stephen Warner.
Sponsors for this evening for putting on this wonderful show and this very, very fun and scary and everything you can ask for a movie. So this movie was the one and only production of Prana Film Productions, and which is the brainchild of F.W. Murnau. Murnau grew up in kind of the northwest corner of Germany. He was the son of a fairly wealthy family. He was very well educated. By the time he was 12, he had read Nietzsche and Shakespeare and Ibsen, and was putting on plays in his backyard. Like everybody, he ended up fighting in World War I. He actually became a pilot and crashed 8 times. And his final crash, he ended up in as a POW in Switzerland and immediately proceeded to put on plays in the POW camp. So right after he got, after World War I, he actually started a production company with Conrad Veidt, who was a part of a circle of actors that he had met in college. And Conrad Veidt has the distinction of being the somnambulist in the cabinet of Caligari. And you may also know him from another film. He was the general, the German general in Casablanca. So he had a career in Hollywood long after being part of the German expressionistic movement. So their early film explorations were always tipped towards creating psychological dramas based on plays and paintings, and always tried to kind of explore kind of deeper truths. Prana Film was founded in 21 in collaboration with Enrico Dykman and an occultist named Alvin Grau, and the whole point of it was to explore films about the supernatural. And of course, in putting together this particular film, this adaptation, Grau was actually inspired because during World War I, he had met a Serbian farmer who said that his father was a vampire. And so that was kind of his prodding towards this story. And unfortunately, Grau didn't do the proper legwork, and they never obtained the rights to the Bram Stoker story. They changed the names of the characters and left out Van Helsing and a few other things and thought that that was enough, and it was not enough, unfortunately. And the Bram Stoker estate sued them after the film came out and ordered, not only wanted financial reimbursement, but also wanted to have all of the prints destroyed. Luckily, a few had gone overseas, and that's why we still have it. So Murnau went on to create many more wonderful films. He did The Last Laugh, which is screened here at Faust, and later immigrated to the United States and worked at Fox and created the absolute masterpiece, Sunrise. He directed films up into the 30s, and unfortunately, his films being kind of an inspiration for the film noir movement, he actually had a very film noir death. He died on the Pacific Coast Highway in a bad car accident. So, going back to Nosferatu, though, this film was shot in Wismar, actually called the city that they're from, Wisborg, but it was shot in a real town called Wismar, but also several scenes were filmed in Lübeck, including the great real estate grab of Count Orlok, the Salzspeicher Lofts, which are still there and have been renovated and are actually quite beautiful now. Shots of Transylvania were shot in Slovakia. The main hero of the story, Hutter, is played by a guy named Gustav von Wagenheim, who later went on to become a big actor in East German communist films. So the original score to this film was composed by a person named Hans Erdmann, and it's a beautiful bit of music. The original score, as a through composed score, doesn't exist. However, there was an orchestral suite which was still extant, and two scholars managed to kind of take those themes out and reproduce it. So if you purchase the DVD or hear a full orchestra production, most likely you'll hear a recreation of Hans Erdmann's score. And that's not what I will be playing tonight. Tonight I will be creating a compiled score, and I'm using the themes of Edvard Grieg. So as we get into the 20s, actually many films could come with a full score. More likely they'd be coming with a cue sheet. And during intermission or after, if you see over by the t-shirt area, there's a little picture on the wall. You actually see there's a cue sheet framed up there from a film. You just get themes kind of listed scene by scene in recommended pieces. My grandfather accompanied silent films as a 15-year-old boy in Iowa, and I actually have all of his cue sheets, and you can see where he scribbled like, yes, I want this, no, I want that. And he just kind of create a musical mood to pass through the film from his extant library. So that's precisely what I've done with Edvard Grieg. This is actually largely from Grieg's Piano Sonata, which is largely unknown, which is why I felt fairly safe to use it. And because it's such a big piece, there's actually most of the themes from the movie are made available from that piece. And also the nice thing about it is that in learning the piece a little bit, Grieg also gives you ideas about how you can manipulate the themes and kind of mix and match them. So the vehicle for this is our marvelous Wurlitzer organ from the Fischer Theater, which was lovingly brought here. It's actually moved twice, if you can imagine. The console is big enough as it is, but actually the instrument occupies more than 1,200 square feet here on the stage, and probably weighs in excess of 30 tons. And so it will be purring and whispering and roaring away through this movie. And there were over 7,000 of these instruments in movie theaters all over the country for this brief period between the early teens and the late 20s. And production for pipe organs in general was just burning white hot at that point, because the organ was a part of the entertainment industry. They were putting pipe organs not only in churches, and at that point there were a lot of large industrial interests growing out of the auto industry. So here in Detroit, there were actually 60 theaters. All the big new churches were getting big new pipe organs, but also organs were going into restaurants and funeral parlors, stadiums, and even residences. There were 40 pipe organs in homes as the home stereo system here in metropolitan Detroit. So the organ was kind of, it is, but like the iPod, after the Depression, it kind of went poof. And a lot of these went into landfills, some went into churches, some went into private homes, and most just sat. And fortunately, this one actually stayed very active up until they went to renovate the Fisher Theater in the early 60s. And George Orbitz won this on a silent bid, and now it's been performing here and created a whole new tradition of concertizing. We've had over 700 concerts on this instrument since 1964. So it's great. It's a great deal of fun to play. It's a magical, magical instrument. One of the joys of playing the pipe organ, all types of pipe organ, classical theater, is that as a musician, you get to enter into dialogue with the instrument. Every instrument is quite different, and each of them kind of tells you what they want you to do. And it's a great privilege to be able to collaborate with this instrument. So in a sense, this evening I'm collaborating with Murnau and all of his acting troupe. I'm with Edvard Grieg and with the Wurlitzer crew who built this beautiful instrument. So after having said all of that, I hope that you can forget all of that and disappear into this marvelous psychological drama, thriller, horror film that Murnau has created for us. So please now enjoy the inimitable Max Schreck as Count Orlok in Nosferatu.
Yeah, while we've been.
We also have to keep the temperature and humidity relatively constant.
Get the length.
Whatever.
It's almost in the ceiling. Gotcha.
Do you have
any questions out of it? Hang on. All these pieces
together. All the ones on the flip. Takes a while for someone to come two of these off.
Too. I mean, there must be like, oh, just a whole.